Today, if I want to find a computer on the internet, I'm going to use a tool like Nmap to find it. But before there were IP addresses on everything, there were phone numbers that were in front of computers. Even today, in many corporations, you'll still have a modem that's left behind on that main router or something in case those internet connections go down. So how do you find those modems that are connected to your enterprise? And how did they, in the 1980s, find computers? They used a tool like THC-SCAN. In this episode of the Infosec Toolshed, we'll talk to the author of THC-SCAN to find out how he wrote it and why.
Before I spoke to the author, I wanted to get some idea of just how important tools like this were back in the 1990s. So I spoke with Dr. Walter Schierer, the author of A History of Fake Things on the Internet and an expert on security culture.
I think we have to understand that computing was a little bit different with respect to computer networks back in the 1990s. And that'll give us some idea of why a tool like a word dialer would actually be useful. A key difference between then and now, many people were accessing information networks through the phone system, right, by using modems, right, these like dial-up devices. That was really good at the time because everybody had, you know, a landline phone. Computers were becoming increasingly cheaper such that, you know, an ordinary person could afford a personal computer. And then to start acquiring interesting peripherals. And one of those peripherals, of course, was the modem. This allowed your computer to dial up and call other computers, right? They would answer, they would exchange information. The bandwidth was quite limited in this early era. That said, most of the information was exchanged textually, so it wasn't a big deal. So what is a war dialer? Why was it really interesting? And why was it a concern in a security sense? Sometime in the 1980s, computer hacking becomes like a subculture. You've got basically young kids, right, like teenagers, college students, starting to recognize that information networks were pretty interesting to play around in. Using a modem, you could reach another computer. Now, this probably started by, like, you know, you were calling your local bulletin board system. It was, you know, perfectly legal, innocent, fun. But eventually someone recognized, hey, if there's this bulletin board system that exists on this particular exchange, right, maybe there are other computers there too. Maybe I can start dialing the numbers sequentially and listening, you know, for tones. And of course you could do that by hand, but that wasn't that efficient. So at some point somebody wrote an automated tool to do this, right? So you could leave your computer all night dialing different phone numbers. In the morning, you could check it and say, aha, like, you know, I found the following carriers, right? Another computer. I wonder what is there, right? And you would dial it up with the terminal program and you know, figure out what was there, perhaps explore that system in ways that may have been legal or illegal, depending on the context. And that of course, becomes a phenomenon after the release of the movie War Games in the 1980s. If you recall that film, Matthew Broderick's character, David Lightman, actually uses a war dialer. That's how he's exploring different computer systems and eventually gets into some big trouble in the film. And so all of a sudden you have, right, a lot of people realizing the utility of this sort of thing.
Today, if you were going to run a war dialer, you'd probably use Warvox. But back in the 1990s, if you wanted a war dialer, you really had two choices. There was ToneLoc and there was THC-SCAN. And support for ToneLoc was somewhat limited. THC-SCAN is just the first of many tools developed by Van Hauser. His other accomplishments include THC Hydra, AMAP, and AFL++, American Fuzzy Lop. Joining me now to talk about his first tool, THC-SCAN, is Van Hauser.
Well, I'm Mark, or pseudonym Van Hauser. I started relatively late, I would say, when I was basically 17, 18. Started coding stuff and was active in mailboxes, so the pre-internet area.
You're with a group that calls themselves THC, or the Hacker's Choice. So what's your involvement with that group there?
I founded that in September, October 1995. So back then I was running a mailbox called Laura BBS because it was about exchanging information and knowledge. Of course, mostly in the area of freaking, hacking, anarchy, all that stuff that I was interested in, which was running on CNET, by the way, so not Wildcat or any other BBS software back then. So it could only run on Amiga, and I didn't have an Amiga back then, so I bought an Amiga, saved my money for that just so I could run that mailbox software. Of course, I preferred that. And so I was running that. I was coding some tools, and at some point I thought of maybe group together with other people and release tools under a common name so things spread easier, it's easier to get known, tools are more often picked up than used and stuff like that. And I had someone on my mailbox who was writing credit card tools, or something I'm not really keen on, but yeah, they were doing that. I was writing some other tools, and then the idea was maybe creating a new group, and that was then the hacker's choice. Of course, THC sounds like cannabis, marijuana, etc., etc. So it was more like, oh, that sounds cool, and what could this acronym stand for? And that was basically the hacker's choice. Then I was rather interested in lots of different tooling, and so I wrote a login hacker that could work over a modem and a war dialer that was THC-SCAN, which would work over, so for finding modems on toll-free numbers. With all my tools, I always try to make them interoperable with other tools. So back then there was a very famous blue boxing freaking tool called Scavenger Dialer. And that guy was also my mailbox and also really cool and really skilled person. So we, for example, combined our tools. So you could combine the war dialer, THC-SCAN, with the scavenger dialer. So the scavenger dialer would, for example, blue box to Iceland, and then THC-SCAN, the war dialer, would look there after the blue boxing to Iceland to look for dial-ins there for modems. Then there was another tool, a third tool, that's one I also programmed, which was a login hacker, which should then automatically start a login hacker, which would then try login passwords on stuff found. And of course, the mailbox helped to connect to people, to distribute the tools, to get interesting people on the mailbox to talk about exchange, etc. And because I wanted to keep it not closed, but so that it feels familiar, let's put it like that, I limited the user number to just 50 people. So everybody had also to be active. So if someone didn't log on for a long time or just logged on and didn't write anything, then people were banned after some time. So it was really also ensuring that everybody was active and, yeah, trying to help each other, basically. That was basically the goal of the mailbox. There were basically only two major mailboxes for hacking, freaking, etc. in Europe. And it was mine, and it was another one in the Netherlands. The one in the Netherlands was focusing on exchanging files, so uploads, downloads, basically, where mine also had uploads, downloads, but the focus one was on messaging.
How big was the community, and how much use did you get initially on your first release?
Difficult to say because there is no telemetry back in the days. Because the scene was so small back then, the audience was also pretty small. Let's put it like that. So there was, of course, there were users, but you would never know who would use the tools because they wouldn't really communicate to you. So could have been thousands of users, could be just a few hundred. But of course, I know there were not that many tools. Basically, there was only one other competitor, which is ToneLog, and that person couldn't continue his tool because at some point that person was in jail.
Can you recall the moment that you decided, you know what, I'm going to write this thing?
I can't really remember how it really started. I remember that ToneLog didn't work for me, so I had errors and it wouldn't find my modem and stuff like that when I tried to use it. So I couldn't war dial as I wanted to, so I think that's the reason why I thought, like, okay, let's write a war dial that actually works for me, and then maybe also for other people. And Another thing is that at that time I had computer science at school, and we were developing a shitty programming language. I think it was called True Basic. Horrible. So I wanted to develop in something better, and I tried to develop in Turbo Pascal and bought a big book like this size on how to develop in Turbo Pascal, and basically by the book I said, okay, now I want to do this. How do I do that? It went through the book. Okay, let's try this. And yeah, and that's basically how I started to develop THC-SCAN, with a book and basically not much clue on how to do stuff. Yeah. But that's also how I learned how to develop it. Basically similar to Hydra, which was my largest C program back then. And that's how I basically learned how to code C.
When the dialer was running, you had nice little windows up that it would show you the logs of what's connecting over here and the status of the current dialing. What was it that made you say, you know what, I'm going to put a GUI on this thing?
Most of my tools are command line tools. So like Hydra, for example. Yeah. So you have lots of command line options. You're in control. You have control. You see the output. You can grab on it and stuff like that. But back then, I basically wanted to see what is happening in real time and what are the statistics and stuff. And you don't have that with a text output and stuff, so just a text file. And not sure if you remember that, but there were also hotkeys that you could do while the war dialing was happening. So you could say early hang up, or you could say, okay, someone is there, so it's a voice number or it's a carrier immediately after hearing it, so you could immediately identify it like that. And other stuff you could do while the process was running. So it needed some kind of user interface that looks nice. And yeah, it was really a challenge because I'm so bad when it comes to UI. So it was a big hassle. And at some point, somebody sent me a library, which made things a bit easier and stuff like that. And yeah, but it was important. And so I did it.